It's October, and this year I decided to go all out and deck my place out for Halloween. And in preparation for Halloween, I thought it'd be the perfect time to bust out one of the most classic horror games, Castlevania.
Castlevania first released in Japan in September 1986, only 1 year after the release of the legendary Super Mario Bros. It showed that a game could take platform elements of Super Mario Bros., but avoid being a complete ripoff. And apart from Mario, it even featured a mature and realistic visual design. Now that's the realism I look for.
But I have a confession to make. While I enjoyed the Castlevania games as a kid, I could never beat them. Now don't think I was bad at games.
I conquered every robot master to come my way in Mega Man, helped Scrooge become the richest duck in the world in DuckTales, and I danced the dance of death with Ninja Gaiden.
I lost.
For some reason, Castlevania was one game that I just couldn't get through. But I'm an adult now, damn it.
Oh, sorry.
But it's time to grow up, grow some balls, and do the grown-up thing to do. Play some video games.
Castlevania begins with an intro as you walk up to Dracula's castle. While this 8-second intro wasn't much, this was one of the first times it was ever done on an NES game, and as such, it became iconic. It really doesn't explain anything about the story, but I mean, what do you need to know? You walk up to an evil-looking castle, cue badass vampire killer music, and that's it. That's all I needed. I mean, look, there is a story if you look in the instruction manual. Congratulations! You have just purchased the authentic Konami home version of Castlevania. That's not the story. I mean, it might as well have been. It's not
that complicated.
You play as Simon Belmont, and as indicated by the instruction manual, this isn't the first time Dracula's had to be slain. In fact, he comes back every 100 years. See that? Konami has some pretty good foresight, and we're ready for a franchise. Just set every new game 100 years apart, and BAM! Franchise! Upon starting the game, you immediately learn the mechanics. If you try attacking the sources of light, you'll be rewarded with upgrades to your whip. Next, you'll receive a heart, and finally a dagger. This is every bit of the game mechanics you need to know, right on the first screen. The game didn't even need to say anything. All it asks for is your general curiosity of what buttons do.
What even is this thing?
Holy shit! You're immediately rewarded with all the info you need to successfully play the game. In fact, an entire first level could be considered a training section for the rest of the game. You'll learn how to climb stairs, and that if you walk next to a staircase, you'll just fall. Which seems like not too big of a deal. But oh, just you wait. Just you wait. So you defeat the first boss, a giant bat, and proceed on to the second level where suddenly... shit... gets... real.
You're gonna hear that music a lot!
And by the way, Simon's walk cycle looks like he's constantly limping. Oh shit, my leg! Oh. Also, it's in this level that you'll really discover, a la the Medusa heads, that if you get hit, you will go flying! What did the Medusa head hit you with? Is its face made out of dynamite? After your introduction to reality, you face off against the Medusa boss, zip your way past the mummy, and reach the cave of pure bullshit! Eventually, you end up at Death, a boss who turns up in every Castlevania game, and upon defeating him, finally make it to the final stage. I mean, we made it this far, can't be too bad, right? Right? The first enemy is the boss of the first level! That's okay, let's just get past him and... oh...
It turns out the best thing to do is to actually follow your first instinct.
You know what I'm talking about. Run the fuck away! Finally, you make it to the entrance to Dracula's chamber. Dracula is a boss who really shouldn't be all that hard. All he does is teleport to one side, then shoot some fireballs you jump over. But with the stiff controls of Castlevania, it ends up being much harder than it really should be. On the bright side, if you lose to him, you do get to start back at the entrance to the boss fight, even with the game over, so it doesn't feel too unfair. Aside for when he decides to teleport on top of you. That that seems unfair. Eventually, with a lot of hard work and determination, you defeat Dracula in his second form, bringing ruin to Castle Dracula and the Count himself. You mentally thank James Banana for composing the music when the game starts you right back at the beginning. Is Castlevania trying to tell me that no matter what the accomplishment, you'll always just have to start over again, and it doesn't really matter what you do? Well, shit. The instruction manual did warn us. But that's all good. I'm a true vampire slayer now, so this'll be easy.
What?
Enemies now hurt you for a quarter of your health bar? And...
never mind. Let's play something a little bit easier. Castlevania 2.
Step into the shadows of the Hell House. You've arrived back here at Transylvania on business to destroy forever the curse of the evil Count Dracula. Destroy? Forever?
See this? This I can get into. Now we can finally stop the infinite cycles. Dracula's gonna be dead forever. This is good.
Okay. Look, I don't want to judge a game without playing. It's certainly not Castlevania 1. But whatever! This is an era of innovation, damn it! Zelda 2 The Adventure of Link had just come out and completely changed the Zelda formula to critical acclaim? And now, Castlevania 2 has decided to take the formula from Metroid and make it in the style of Castlevania. That sounds like a winning formula, right?
I mean, Symphony of the Night did the same thing.
We start in some random town this time around, which right away hints that the towns are important. And talking to people in town? Equally important. 13 clues will solve Dracula's riddle. See? Right there! We need to find clues, and where else to find them other than talking to people? Rumor has it the ferryman at Dead River loves garlic. Well, so do I, but I don't go on bragging about it.
Have you ever seen so many cloves of garlic in one shot?
A magic potion will destroy the wall of evil. Okay, so we need to find a magic potion and a wall of evil. The magic potion can be purchased in the first town, but we need more hearts, so it's time to venture out into the wild to farm hearts from enemies. The game itself is far easier than the first Castlevania game, as this time you can run back and forth from screen to screen in order to explore, so that enemies aren't designed to be in the most murderous places possible. And that's when we run into the most infamous line in Castlevania 2. What a horrible night to have a curse. Promptly after seeing this text, everything turns to shit. All the monsters outside become more difficult to kill, and all the residents of the town turn into ghouls.
Which would all be fine, except for that you can't talk to anyone in town during this, meaning...
you sort of just end up playing a waiting game whenever you need to actually use the town. Remember, that thing that's so important? The game starts you there!
Alright, I get it. I just want to buy some potions. Wait, can that happen in real life?
So now that we've grinded our way through the night, we can finally afford both the magic potion and an upgraded whip. Searching through multiple towns and dungeons, it turns out the evil wall is... any fucking wall. As long as the wall is made up of blocks, it just might be an evil wall! You also purchase a white orb, which it turns out, and this is never explained, if you equip it, you can access the first dungeon. In the first dungeon, you process the rib of Dracula. Yes, process, which you can then use as a shield. That's right, your shield in this game is someone's ribcage. At this point, you've started the main quest of the game, which it turns out is to collect the various body parts of Dracula. And this is when I started to feel stuck. That is, until discovering this.
The thing is, I like secrets in games, but you have to establish it first, especially if it's vital to making progress in the game. I spent a half hour stuck, not sure what to do.
Until I angrily started spamming throwing magic potions at the ground. And guess what? Remember that garlic we needed for the ferryman? Well, here it is! Underground! So, fine. We take the garlic to the ferryman and, hey, you wanted some garlic, right? Because that was the clue I found and... hold on a second. Another warning from the spirit. A few friendly villagers are town pranksters and their clues are false. Of course, you'll never know until you take the chance.
What the fuck is the game?
So not only do the clues suck, but we also find out that some of them are fake clues. Okay, let's just try talking to the ferryman then. And what do you know? That's all it takes. He offers to take us to a good place, so expecting the best. We hop a ride with him to continue on to the... In the end, the ferryman takes us to actually a pretty awesome place. I'll see you at midnight on the river bank. Oh, alright then. I want to get to know you better. I've been waiting for a good-looking guy like you. Is this horny lady town?
'Cause you know, I'm okay with that.
Continuing along the path, you'll end up all the way at a new mansion at a dead end.
So at this point, I tried everything to not resort to using a strategy guide.
I checked every Tom Nook, every cranny, tried my magic potion on every single wall and floor panel, to the point where I finally conceded. It turns out, in order to progress, you need to trade your white orb for a blue orb in one of the villages. Then, you need to go to the specific dead end with a river, equip the blue orb, and crouch for 5 seconds.
I mean, I almost had it.
So, new knowledge in hand, you trade your blue orb for a red orb, equip it, and crouch for 5 seconds at that random dead end to be taken by a whirlwind to another mansion. In doing so, you can finally access the rest of the evil mansions, process the rest of Dracula's body parts, and head into the manor of Dracula himself. Now, up to this point, the game has been fairly easy. To play, I mean, not to understand and figure out the riddles, which are fucking impossible. But now it's time for Dracula. Time for the final boss. See that? That's some scary shit. A legendary battle away.
I don't brag often, but. Oh wait, I have one more game left to play.
Castlevania 3. This time around, you find out the village folk became afraid of the Belmonts for their awesome power and ability to kill Dracula, and in thanks for saving everybody, kicked them out of the countryside. As Dracula returns again, fortunately, for some reason, Trevor Belmont decides to come save their sorry asses anyways. After the complaints and issues with Castlevania 2, Castlevania 3 returns to form and is in the same style as Castlevania 1, a brutally difficult platform game. Like Castlevania 1, we start with a mini-intro as Trevor Belmont is looking over a coffin. Because necrophilia? Okay when you're a hero! Belmont. Shit. Alright, look, Trevor's weird. He's the Belmont in the family nobody likes talking about. Once again, cue badass music as the game immediately teaches you about whip upgrades, hearts, and special weapons right off the bat. This time though, as you finish the first boss, you're given a choice of where to go next. If you choose the upwards path into the clock tower, you'll eventually reach a boss who, upon defeat, turns into Grant, will beg to be taken with you, and if you accept, congratulations. You have made the best decision ever! This handshake should last forever. Why is Grant so awesome, you ask? Because clean the walls! He may not be as powerful as Trevor, he may not have the range of Trevor's whip, but he can climb along ceilings and up walls. Grant alone makes this game. You can gain 2 more allies along the way, if you so choose, but can only take along one at a time. If you travel the upwards path and head into Dracula's castle via the front door, you can gain the wizard Sitha as an ally who has incredibly powerful magic you can use and utilize using your hearts. Oh, and her main weapon is a stick.
Yeah! Mwah! A stick, man's best friend. Alright, human's best friend.
By taking the other path, you'll eventually face this boss, who highly resembles Dracula, but upon defeating him, turns out to be Alucard. Yes, the Alucard that was eventually used in Castlevania Symphony of the Night, just looking a whole lot more like his father, Dracula. Alucard will request to join you on your fight against Dracula, and if you choose to use him, can turn into a bat, allowing you to fly past several of the upcoming obstacles. Regardless of which path you take, though, you'll end up dying a lot, as this game is even more difficult than Castlevania 1. You then end up at a familiar setting, the beginning of Castlevania 1. Now that you've finally made it to the castle itself, you'll quickly discover that everything on the way there was mere child's play. Remember Death? He was pretty hard. Well, guess what? Two forms! Hey, your character seems pretty strong. Guess what? Doppelganger boss hurts you for a quarter your health each time. And at last, you make it to the final stage. A stage where this joke won't work if I have to use it for how often you die. This level alone is like Konami saying, "Hey, I heard you complain that Castlevania 2 is too easy. Well, we heard you, and don't worry, we're on top of that shit." If you can make it past the ceiling trying to crush you, the ground crumbling beneath you, and giant swinging pendulums, you'll finally make it to Dracula's notorious staircase. This is it, the final battle.
Oh no.
Oh! This time around, when you face Dracula, he'll summon pillars of flame to hit you, and if you get hit, that's a quarter of your health gone. Also, unlike Castlevania 1, if you die against Dracula, you have to start at the last checkpoint and work your way towards him. And if you get a game over, well, that means you have to start at the beginning of the level again. Oh, and did I mention that Dracula no longer has just two forms, but three fun forms to tackle and take on?
I can't believe I'm saying this, but I miss Castlevania 2.
Your reward for beating Castlevania 3? New Game Plus mode with even harder enemies! Because at this point, the game has you figured out that if you got this far, you're obviously a masochist.
While these Castlevania NES games were brutally hard for varying reasons, Castlevania 2, I'm looking at you. These games feature some of the best platform design in their day and were a true challenge for anyone who deemed themselves worthy. Not only that, but they led to one of my favorite games of all time,
Castlevania Symphony of the Night, which featured a similar design philosophy to Castlevania 2, Alucard of Castlevania 3, and all the enemies we've met and grown to hate throughout the series.
Oh look, the morning sun is here, the horrible night's finally over.
Great.
Rich, I didn't see you there, I'm sorry. Come on, friends?
Okay,